In this lesson, we're going to wrap up our initial discussion, at least, of the double replacement reaction and move on to single replacement reactions. Okay, we're going to continue to look at double replacement reactions right now. You had five more problems to do. Well, six actually, I guess, because we did the first four already. Get out your homework and let's go over the remaining six problems. And then we'll go on and discuss single replacement reactions. I have a lab plan for single replacement reactions. Okay, so number five on our list. Oh, and regarding the lab, if I can get to it today, I'm going to email you a set of the procedures. And there's a pre-lab you have to do. We won't do the lab until at least Tuesday, but the pre-lab is kind of extensive, so I would make sure you check your email and get started on that this weekend, so you don't get a whole bunch to do all in one night.
Okay.
Okay, so here's the equation number five. Well, I'm trying to be patient with you, but I'd like to get a break from the complaining, okay?
Well, I'm just saying. I know.
I understand, but I'm just asking, okay? All right, so let's see here. And we got this. Again, we have silver nitrate. And if I have two ionic compounds, then we're going to look at the products by double replacement, okay? We know this is an ionic compound because it has a polyatomic ion in it. Anytime you have a formula with more than two elements, one of the first things you need to do is look on the common ions list and see if you have a polyatomic ion. If you have a polyatomic ion, it's an ionic compound. Same is true with this. So we're going to take this A part, and we're going to join it up with the D part over here. In the handout that I gave you on this, we will label this the first part of the double formula was A, the second part is B, this is C, and this is D. And so we're going to take the front part of this and put it with the back part of this, and we get BaNO3. The front part of this goes with the back part of this, AgNO3. Well, you might already see what's going on here. Basically, we got the same two formulas we started with, right? Does everybody see that? And we haven't balanced this one. Do we have to? Because we're going to get the same thing if we balance it. This is balanced already. It should balance out the same as this. That makes this compound aqueous and this compound aqueous, and we know that because those two are both aqueous, right? And if I don't make water, H2O or HOH, and if I don't make something that's a solid, or if I don't make something that's a gas, and right now we haven't talked about the ways you make a gas, but if we don't make one of those three things, and this so far, all you're really looking for is solids and water, then there's no reaction, just NR, and we're done. Okay? Now, because you could look at this and figure it out, normally I would give you 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 points for this, but you might have looked at this and realized, oh, this is the same stuff, and left off the AQ part of it, okay? So I'm just going to give points for this one for 1, 2, and not count the AQs. 3, 4, 5, 6. 6 points for this problem, okay? And we go to number 6. And number 6 starts with lead acetate. Oh, that's C2H3. Man, And that's going to be O2 and then a parenthesis and a 2. Kind of scrunch that up a little bit. And that's AQ. And then we're putting that with barium nitrate. Okay. So lead acetate and barium nitrate. We're going to take the front part of this and put it with the back part of that. But that's only if it's double replacement. We know this is double replacement, or if there is a reaction, it's going to be double replacement because we have a two part compound here and a two part compound here. And so the front part goes with the back part of this, PbNO3, BaC2H3O2. If you didn't know the names of these compounds, to be able to compare that to the solubility rules, you'd use your common ions list. In this class, you can use a common ions list. In an honors class, you can't. So we look at this formula here. We just find the ion that appears to be the same. So C2H3O2 is acetate. Okay? NO3 is nitrate. You go to the solubility rules, and it says that all nitrates and all acetates, they're right here, both in the same rule, all acetates and all nitrates are always soluble. There are no exceptions listed out here to the right. So both these are going to be aqueous. We have not created anything that is going to be a solid. We haven't created H2O or HOH. There's no water, so this is no reaction. Okay, and this is worth 8 points. Eight, because this time I am counting the AQs. Okay? And now we're going to go to number 7 on the list. Sodium hydroxide. And you need to know how to name these. We did that a couple of units ago. This is the hydroxide ion. You name it just the way it appears on the common ions list. This is a sodium metal. Metals get named exactly the same name as they have on the periodic table. The only change is when they have more than one oxidation number, you have to use a Roman numeral to name the charge number. And we're going to put that with barium nitrate. And sodium then is going to join up with the nitrate. Barium is going to join up with the hydroxide. And the first thing we want to do is to figure out physical states. Nitrate compounds, and this is a group 1 metal. It's found in the first column of the periodic table here. So all the metals in this column are called group 1 metals. Hydrogen is not a metal, so it's not one of the group 1 metals. Okay, but all the group 1 metals, if you look on the solubility rules, it says group 1 metal salts are always soluble. Okay, so this is always soluble because it's got sodium in there, but it's also soluble because all nitrates are always soluble and no exceptions. So that's aqueous. Now we're going to look for hydroxide. Here is hydroxide down here in the insoluble section. It says that hydroxides are insoluble. So most hydroxides are going to be solids. But there are exceptions when you are combining hydroxides with group 1, strontium, and ding, 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 barium. So if it's not going to be a solid, it will be aqueous. And that makes that no reaction. Okay, so this one's also no reaction. Okay, number 8 then, we're going to have iron and sulfate. We'll talk about what that iron, the name of that iron is in just a minute. And that's listed here as aqueous. We're putting that with barium nitrate. Okay. And so the iron is going to join up with the nitrate. Barium is going to join up with the sulfate. Okay. First thing you want to do is to figure out physical states. Nitrates, we said several times, they are always soluble, no exceptions, so that's aqueous. Sulfates. Here's sulfates, and sulfates are usually soluble. There are some exceptions. One of those exceptions is barium. So while most sulfates are soluble, and if there's water around, as we show here, it'll dissolve, this particular sulfate with barium is not going to be soluble, so it will be a solid. And you do have a driving force for this reaction. So that's the first thing, is to find out whether you have a driving force. So we're going to continue now. These others up here, you stopped when you found out there was no reaction. Now we got to continue. So we get to figure out how to balance this formula. We know the charge on a nitrate. Nitrates have a one negative charge, or if you didn't know, you could easily look it up. It's on your common ions list. Nitrate has a one negative charge. Okay? Now, iron, we don't know the charge for. Iron has more than one possible oxidation number. Iron has two possible oxidation numbers. It has a 3+ charge and a possible 2+ charge. Okay? So we need to know which one this one is. Since we don't know in the beginning, we've got to go over here and see which one this one is. Now, here's what we do know. Sulfates, if you look it up on your common ions list, sulfates have a 2 negative charge, okay? And I have 3 sulfates. This subscript 3 outside the parentheses tells me I have 3 of those, okay? So 3 times 2 negative gives me a 6 negative. We have 2 irons, and we're trying to figure out the charge on it. And we need a charge on the iron that's going to neutralize this 6 negative charge. That's a 3+ we need, right? Therefore, this iron is going to be 3+. So this iron is going to be 3+. So in order to balance this formula, then I need 3 nitrates to balance it out. Does that make sense? Okay. Barium is in the second column of the periodic table. All the metals in the second column of the periodic table have a 2+ charge. And sulfate, we just said, has a 2 negative charge. So that those two cancel out. That's already balanced. So now the formulas are balanced, okay? Now listen, once the formulas are balanced, you cannot change the formulas. What we're going to do to balance the equation is to use only coefficients in front of the element symbols or the compound symbols, okay? The deal is that once you get your formulas balanced, don't touch them. Got it? Or I send Darth Vader after you. Got it? All right. No, we're not doing it again. Oh, once the formulas are balanced like this, listen, once the formulas are balanced, I've got no subscript on the Fe, I've got a subscript 3 over here on the end of the NO3. Once that's balanced, you don't mess with it anymore. The only thing you're going to do when you're balancing the equation is put coefficients in front of these formulas, okay? So that's all that's about. Just trying to get you to think that, okay? It's the Darth Vader theme in the beginning of that video. That's what happens when you start touching that. Got it? Right. Don't touch that. There you go. All right, now we're going to do an atom inventory here. Now, I've got oxygen in this formula, but I've also got oxygen in this formula, so I'm not going to list it twice. Okay, just need to list it one time. I always try to put the line right here directly under the arrow, because that helps me to remember, and that's what I'm asking you guys to do. It helps me to remember that everything on this side goes in this column. Everything on this side of the equation goes in this column. So now we're ready to count all of the atoms we have currently. Well, on this side, I've got 2 irons. This 3 outside the parentheses means I have 3 sulfur atoms, and it means I've got 4 times 3, or 12 oxygen atoms, but I've also got 3 times 2 oxygen atoms over here. There's 12 plus 6, or currently 18 oxygens on the left. I've got 1 barium, and this 2 outside the parentheses means everything inside gets multiplied by 2. There's 1 nitrogen in the nitrate formula. 2 times 1 gives me 2 nitrogens. Over on the other side, at the moment, I've got 1 iron, 1 sulfur. I have 3 times 3, or 9 oxygens, plus 4 oxygens, gives me 13 oxygens initially. I have 1 barium, And I've got 3 times what's inside the parentheses, so 3 times 1, or 3 nitrogens. Okay? That's where we start. Remember, we're going to do oxygen last. We're going to balance it the very last. So I can just start with iron. Since I have 2 on the left and 1 on the right, I need to put a coefficient 2 in front of this, which will change the number of irons and nitrogens and oxygens. Now let's count up those. I now have 2 irons. I had 3 nitrogens because 3 outside the parentheses means that everything inside got multiplied by 3, and there's 1 nitrogen in a nitrate formula. So 3 times 1 is 3, then times 2, 6 nitrogens at the moment, right? Now the oxygens, I have 3 here, times 3 is 9, times 2 is 18, plus 4 gives me 22, right?
Yeah.
All right, so currently I have 22 oxygens. All right, so the irons are balanced, but the sulfur is not balanced. So let's get the sulfur to balance by putting a coefficient of 3 in front of this species containing the barium sulfate. That's going to change the number of bariums and sulfurs and oxygens again.
3.
I did say 3 because I need 3 sulfurs. Okay? All right. That's going to give me 3 bariums. It's going to give me 3 sulfurs. And the oxygens now, 3 times 3, 9, times 2 is 18, plus 4 times 2 is 12. So that's 30 oxygens. Okay? Now, the irons and the sulfurs are balanced. Now we've got to get the bariums balanced because we're going to save oxygen for last. If I have 3 on the right, to get 3 on the left, I'm going to put a coefficient 3 in front of this species containing the barium, which will change the number of bariums, the number of nitrogens, and the number of oxygens. Okay? So I now have 3 bariums. I had 1 nitrogen in the nitrate formula times 2, so that's 2 nitrogens, times 3 gives me 6. Let's count up all the oxygens then. I've got 4 times 3, or 12 here. Over here I've got 3 times 2 is 6, times 3 is 18. That's going to give me 30 oxygens. And now finally everything is balanced. Okay? Let's count up all the points for the things you had to do. You had to have a coefficient here. You had to have a coefficient here. You had to have iron, parentheses, nitrate, subscript 3, aqueous, plus 3, barium, sulfate, solid. Okay, so for 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13 for the equation part. In the atom inventory, the only thing I'm not giving points for is this 22 and its canceling, because there's more than one way to balance the equation. However, if the equation is balanced properly, you'll have the beginning number to be exact correct. The cancellations are all going to be the same for the beginning number, and the ending numbers will be the same. So this is the only one we don't count for giving points, okay? So that we've got 5 elements here, that's 5 points. 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31, and 32 for the grid itself. So 32 plus 13 gives me 55 points for this problem. And number 9. Number 9 was zinc chloride. And iron sulfate, or iron 3 sulfate. I said a while ago I was going to tell you about what the name of the iron was, and I never really got back to that. It's the same formula as this one right here. Because there's a 3 plus on the iron, we call it iron 3. Any metal, and only metals that have more than one oxidation number, must be named with a Roman numeral, not to tell you how many irons there are, but to tell you what the charge on the iron is. Okay? So this is an iron 2. This is iron 3.
Mr. Taylor, I suppose
Alright, the only way to get all this balanced out is if I put a 3 here and a 2 here that I can see right now. Okay, so now let's count everything up. We've got 3 leads now. I have 2 carbons in the acetate, times 2 is 4, then times 3 is 12 carbons. 3 hydrogens times 2, that's 6, times 3 is 18. Now for the oxygens, I've got 2 here, times the 2 is 4, times the 3 is 12, plus I've got 4 times 3 here for another 12, so I've got 24 oxygens at the moment. Okay, on the other side, I now have 2 irons. I have 2 carbons in the acetate ion, times 3 is 6, times that 2 is 12 carbons, okay? I've got 3 hydrogens, times 3 is 9, times 2 is 18, and oxygens. I've got 4 here, and here I've got 2, times 3 is 6, times 2 is 12, for a total of 16. So that's 16 oxygens, right? All right, so now I've got to get the sulfur's balance, yes? All right, so I need a 3 in front of this compound. Or I could have gone up here and done the lead. The lead needs to be balanced, too. So that gives me, that's going to change the number of leads, the number of sulfurs, and the number of oxygens. All right, gives us 3 leads, gives us 3 sulfurs, 3 times 4 is 12 oxygens. 2 times 3 is 6, times 2 is 12, 24, and we've got 24 oxygens, and everything's balanced. Okay, got a point for this coefficient, got a point for this coefficient, a point for lead, sulfate, and the sulfur, I mean the solid, a point for the plus sign, a point for the coefficient, iron, parentheses, and we'll give 1 point for both the opening and closing parentheses, the acetate ion, the subscript 3, and aqueous. So for the equation, it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12 for the equation. Okay? For the inventory, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31, 32, 33, 34, 35, 36, 37, 38, 39. So it's 39 for the atom inventory. So 2 and 9 makes 11, carry a 1, that makes a 51. 51 points for that, right? For 9, 8 points. Okay, let me add these up first and I'll answer your question. Okay, so we got 6 points here at the top, plus 8 points, plus 8 points. Plus 45. Oop. Plus 45. Plus 51, right? And I got 118 points for total for everything. So let's talk now about single replacement reactions. When we were doing double replacement reactions, we were using the solubility rules to find out what kind of products we had and whether those products were going to be aqueous or solids. All right, give me your attention, please. This is really important. This is really important. I need your attention. So for single replacement reactions, you're still going to have to be able to use the solubility rules. But in addition, and primarily, you're going to need the activity series. Okay? That's what you're supposed to annotate. Okay? So hopefully you've got a pretty good idea of what we're doing here. Okay? So let's take a look at how this works. With a single replacement reaction, instead of having two-part compounds, you're going to have something that's by itself and a two-part compound. Okay? For a single replacement reaction, you've got to have something that's by itself and a two-part compound. So that's like having A plus BC. Okay? Now, A, if it's a metal, can replace B. Actually, it could be a metal or hydrogen. Okay? A can replace, A if it's a metal, can replace another metal. A, if it's a metal, can replace a hydrogen. In some cases, hydrogen can replace a metal. So in this case, even though we say that hydrogen is not a metal, in the case of single replacement reactions, it kind of behaves like a metal. All right? At least in this context. Now, if A replaces the front part of this, then we're going to get A with C, and we're going to get B by itself. Okay, that's one kind of single replacement reaction. But A could be a halogen, and if C is also a halogen, A can replace C. And so what we get then is B with A, and we get C by itself.
What's a halogen?
Halogen, if you remember when we were doing the periodic table and all the regions of the periodic table, everything in column 7A is a halogen.
Okay.
Okay? This only works if this is a halogen and if this is a halogen.
So why would you replace it if they're both a halogen?
Because some halogens are more active than other halogens, hence the activity series. The activity series. Okay, those that are more reactive, or more active, will replace those that are less active.
Okay, so what if the one that's already there on, like, for C, what if that's more reactive than A?
Then you have no reaction.
Okay.
Just like we did with double replacement reactions. Okay, so let's look at a couple of these. Let's take, say we have strontium metal, okay, and we're going to put that in a compound that is zinc chloride. And zinc chloride will dissolve in water. We're going to put it in water and dissolve it. Okay, so we have to predict the products over here now. Okay, we're going to predict the products. I need to know if this metal, with the part that's by itself, is more active than the part it is like in the compound. Okay? If it's more active, it will replace it.
What?
So we're going to look on the activity series and see that strontium is here and that zinc, which is the part it's like, is down here. Now, this zinc down here is not zinc the metal, it's zinc the ion because it's combined with a nonmetal. So this is zinc with a 2 plus charge, and you'll find that in the second column here. So strontium, the metal that's by itself, is more active than zinc, the metal ion in a compound. And it will replace zinc. Okay? All right. So strontium is going to replace zinc in this chloride compound. So we'll get strontium and chlorine. And zinc is going to be replaced, so it's going to be by itself. Now, the driving force for double replacement reactions was the formation of a solid, or the formation of water, or the formation of a gas. For single replacement reactions, that is not the driving force. So you have to know, first of all, is this single replacement or is it double replacement? And if it's single replacement, the driving force is when one part, the part that's by itself, the metal or halogen or hydrogen that's by itself is more active than the metal or halogen that's or hydrogen in the compound. So this is where you're going to get your driving force for a single replacement reaction. Now here's the thing. That being the case, you don't have to figure out what the products are to figure out if there's a driving force. If there's a driving force, you're going to know it just from the reactants. Okay? I'll show you that in a minute. All right. So strontium joins up with chlorine. We know we have a driving force. We know these are the products. Zinc is a metal. So if it's by itself, it's going to be a solid. You just got to know that, guys. Metals that are by themselves, with the exception of mercury and gallium maybe, okay, those are going to be solids. Okay? Strontium chloride, we need to know if it's soluble. That's where the solubility rules come in. Okay, so chlorides, we see, are almost always soluble. There are some exceptions for silver, lead, and mercury 1, but this is strontium. It's not silver, lead, or mercury 1. So this chloride compound will be soluble. Since there is water, this is aqueous. Okay. Now we need to balance this formula. Strontium is in the second column of the periodic table. All the metals in the second column of the periodic table, when they're in a compound, will have a 2 plus charge. This is going to have a 2 plus charge. Chlorine is in column 7A. All the elements in column 7A in a 2-part ionic compound, in a 2-part ionic compound, will always have a 1 negative charge. Chlorine has a 1 negative charge. So I need to have 2 chlorines to balance the formula, and I'll put a subscript 2 here. Okay? Now we've got the formulas done. Once I get the formulas done, what do I do with them? Leave them alone. Do nothing with them. Okay? Now we're ready to balance the equation. We're going to put in a list here, strontium and zinc and chlorine. Count up everything. 1 strontium, 1 zinc, 2 chlorines over on this side. 1 strontium, 1 zinc, 2 chlorines is balanced. But you got to show me the atom inventory because I'm from Missouri. Not really, but that's what I say. Okay? Look it up. It's supposed to mean you go to your internet and use Google. All right. Let's take copper and put it in a solution of nickel chloride. First thing I want to know is for a single replacement reaction. Now look, guys, this is not double replacement. I don't have 2 2-part compounds. I have one thing that's by itself and a 2-part compound. That tells me that if I'm going to have a reaction, it's most likely single replacement. I need to know if this is more active than the part it's like. So look on your activity series. Find your activity series and determine, just as I did before, whether copper is more active than nickel. Is copper more active than nickel? Look for yourself. Don't take Tyrese's word for it. Yeah, find your own answers.
Which one's copper?
Copper is Cu. It's the friendly goodbye element. What?
Is
copper more active than zinc? I mean, nickel.
No.
Because this is a metal, and this is a metal ion. So if there's going to be a replacement, it's going to replace, metal's going to replace metal. You're going to look on the activity series. The more active metals are at the top. The less active metals are at the bottom. And there's hydrogen in here too. Remember I said hydrogen behaves kind of like a metal in this context? Okay. So here's copper. Is nickel above it or below it?
Above it.
It's right up here. So is copper more active than nickel? No. So therefore, it's not going to replace nickel. And we have no reaction. We're done. We're ready to go. Ones that are at the top, or those that are above, are more active than those that are below. Okay? All right, then. let's take iron and let's put it in a solution of hydrochloric acid. All right. Which part of this compound, in the context of single replacement reactions, which part of this compound is iron-like?
Hydrogen.
It's like the hydrogen in the context of single replacement reactions. So is iron more active than the hydrogen ion?
Yes,
it's higher. So will it displace the hydrogen ion?
Yes.
So iron then is going to join up with the part it's not like, the chlorine. And hydrogen will be by itself. Now here's the only tricky part with hydrogen. Hydrogen, when it's by itself, is not just H. It's a diatomic element. So when hydrogen gets displaced, it becomes H2. On the periodic table, we've done this before, we said that hydrogen, nitrogen, oxygen, fluorine, and chlorine are all diatomic gases. Bromine is a diatomic liquid, and iodine can be either a gas or solid at room temperature. So as a gas, it's also diatomic. Okay? So all of these are diatomic under certain circumstances. This is the only one that's even any question at all. And it depends on whether it's a solid or it's going to be a gas. Okay? Because it sublimates basically at room temperature. Okay, but nitrogen, oxygen, fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine, you can always consider those to be diatomic. Because the Fe is like the hydrogen in the context of single replacement reactions, because hydrogen is over here, and because it says so right here.
It's more active.
Iron is more active than hydrogen. Okay? Right. Now, a while ago, when we were doing single replacement, double replacement reactions, we said that iron has two different oxidation numbers. I didn't figure out, well, which one of those oxidation numbers do I use here? Well, in this case, it tells you right here what it's going to be. Okay? You have no way to know, just from looking at these, that iron will go from, by the way, iron by itself as a solid has a zero oxidation number. Any element that's by itself has a zero oxidation number. So the hydrogen also has a zero oxidation number because it's by itself. Okay? But this iron, we got to figure out, it has to change its oxidation number, change its charge number in order to combine with chlorine. So we need to figure out which one it is. And that's why I have this column with those charges listed for you. This is going to be iron 2. Chlorine is always a 1 negative charge. So how many chlorines do I need?
Two.
Two, and that's going to be FeCl2. All right? So there's water around. Chlorides are mostly soluble, so in water they will be aqueous unless they're bonded with one of these. And it says iron 3. I'm sorry. Iron is not one of those exceptions for chlorides. I was looking at fluorides. Okay, there's no exception for iron, only silver, lead, and mercury 1. So this is going to be what physical state?
Aq.
Aq. All right. What physical state is hydrogen, the gas?
The gas.
Okay. Yeah, I know. I'm just repeating it for emphasis, okay? Hydrogen, when it gets made in an H2 form, is always a gas. Now we're ready to balance the equation, guys. Iron. Hydrogen, chlorine. Starting out with one iron, one hydrogen, one chlorine. Over on this side, we're starting out with one iron, two chlorines, and two hydrogens. So what do I need to balance this equation? Put a 2 here, change these two, 2 and 2, and now that equation's balanced. You got it? All right, getting close on time, so let me just show you the last thing you need to know, and that is that there is an activity series for metals and hydrogen, but there's a separate activity series for halogens down here, guys. OK? Okay? So, let's take chlorine, the gas. We said that chlorine is diatomic. Let's put it in a solution that contains, how about sodium bromide? All right. Is chlorine, the halogen, more active than something that it's like in this compound? Is chlorine, the halogen, more active than something it's like in this compound? Yes. Because sodium has a 1 plus charge and bromine has a 1 negative charge. That's a balanced compound. Yeah, it's when it's by itself it becomes Br2. Okay, so is chlorine more active than bromine because they're both halogens?
Yes.
It is more active, therefore chlorine will displace the bromine. And we're going to get NaCl, which you guys are familiar with, I hope. And now bromine's by itself. And guys, that is where the subscript 2 comes in. Okay, so that's Br2, it's by itself. Sodium chloride, there's water around, will sodium chloride dissolve? You kind of should know that one.
Yeah.
Practical experience. Will table salt dissolve?
Yeah.
So that's aqueous. And bromine, of the halogens, fluorine and chlorine by themselves are gases. Bromine is a liquid. You can treat iodine like a liquid or a solid, okay? But bromine is going to be a liquid. You have to show me a script L because it's hard to tell lowercase l's from numbers 1. Or a capital I. Okay, so make it a script L, please. All right, and now we're ready to balance the equation. All right, now I'm not going to stop and balance the equation because we're almost out of time. Let me assign your homework. All right, so on the back of your handout, I think there are 20 problems on there, is that right?
Yep. Well,
on the handout that I gave you the other day to annotate for a single replacement?
Yes.
Since you're going to be working, I hope you're going to be working on your lab. Let's just do the first 5 of those for homework, okay? First 5.
Can't touch this. Can't touch this. Can't touch this. Give me a song, a rhythm, make them sweat. That's what I'm giving them now. They know, you talk about the hammer.